Welcome to Question Time. Good evening, everyone. So once again, welcome to you all. And I look forward to a feisty evening with a lot of views, and I hope very much that we're going to be able to dialogue, as they say nowadays, with you in the audience and to have good communication. Can I introduce our distinguished panel today? On my far right is Lord McNally, or Tom as I know him. Tom was a distinguished minister in the coalition government. He's been a Liberal Democrat peer since 1995 and succeeded Baroness Williams as leader of the party in the House of Lords. He was the Minister of Justice under Kenneth Clark in the coalition until his resignation in 2013, following his appointment as chairman of the Youth Justice Board. Tom. On my immediate right is Gisela Stuart MP for Birmingham Edgbaston, whom most of you will know because she's almost never off the radio or indeed the television. So we know you very well. Gisela is the chair of Vote Leave, the official Brexit campaign group. She's a Labour MP for Birmingham Edgbaston, a traditionally conservative seat who isn't afraid to defy the whip, which she does very often. She was first elected in 1997, and under Blair served on the Commons Foreign Affairs Committee and was Under Secretary of State for Health. Gisela. On my left is Keith Miles, the former financial director for the Institute of Economic Affairs. Keith has very kindly stepped into Daniel Hannan's shoes at very short notice on behalf of Vote Leave, as well as his policy-making work for the IEA. He's a fellow of the Institute of Chartered Accountants and was awarded the OBE for his services to Anglo-Slovene relations. Keith. And Richard Angell, who's the director of Progress, a group for Labour's progressives. He was the national chair of Young Labour, secretary of LGBT Labour, and served on Labour's National Policy Forum under Ed Miliband's leadership. He was also elected to the LGBT committee of the TUC and is a former official of the community union. Richard. And on my far left, Steve Crowther, who's chairman of UKIP. Steve Crowther is the chairman of UKIP. Before going into politics, he spent 30 years in London working as a journalist and businessman. He became chairman in 2010 and in 2015 stood in the general election in his hometown of North Devon, where he came third. He's a member of Grassroots Out or Go. Steve. Now, we've got a host of provocative questions, and I'm going to start off by asking Harvey Purnell to ask his question.
Hello. My question is, do you think the UK should follow examples set in US states such as California, Colorado, and Washington, and legalise cannabis within the United Kingdom?
Do you think that the UK should follow the example set by US states such as Washington, Colorado, and California, and legalise cannabis? How about Richard?
Thank you. I'm afraid I don't, is my initial reaction. I don't think it's right to do that for the UK. They're doing different things in those different states. Some are legalising it, some are decriminalising it. I actually think decriminalising it is the worst of all worlds. That is a licence for drug dealers to go round and be able to do what they will. And that really is when things like cannabis are a gateway drug to others. I'm very inspired personally by Justin Trudeau, who is the new Liberal Prime Minister of Canada, and he is looking at whether it's right to legalise it for Canada, which would be interesting, and his key argument is it will take away, it will break the link between the dealer and the drug, which would be is the only good argument for it, in my opinion, but I don't think it's the right thing for the UK.
Thank you. Tom.
I share some of Richard's concerns. Cannabis is not the easy drug that it's sometimes presented. Skunk cannabis is very dangerous, can cause many psychotic problems. Mm. But I think one of the things that we've got to face is that the so-called war on drugs has been an abysmal failure, and in many ways has funded organized crime in a way that prohibition did in the United States in the 1920s. So I think it's sensible to try and keep an open mind on this, have a look at what happens in Washington, Colorado, and California, have a look at what the Canadians do, but proceed with caution on it, because this is not an easy option. And of course, the whole thing about drugs is that there are always new factors, the so-called legal highs that are now available. What is still the best advice is don't.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Steve, legalising cannabis.
Yeah, it's. I think there, it is tempting. It is definitely tempting. And my party is very much.
Sabotage.
Yes. is this not party political?
It might be indigestion.
Thank you,
Steve. Broken the system already, look at that. It is tempting. We tend to take a broadly libertarian view, take the view that people should be able to live their lives as they choose, as long as they're not incommoding others. But having said that, there are so many dimensions to this question. Our party policy in our manifesto last year was not to legalise or decriminalise, but certainly Nigel Farage has been on record as saying that he thinks that probably there should be a Royal Commission to try and get to the bottom of this. I don't think we have enough evidence. And for me, what struck me is that when I was at college in the 1970s and didn't smoke dope, obviously. It was a sort of rather social, sort of mild thing not to do with your friends, which led to lots of pleasant evenings. When I next encountered this after 20 years of work in the 1990s, and obviously didn't smoke it again, I discovered that it changed dramatically, and the product simply isn't that sort of little thing that's a bit like having a couple of scotches. It's now something that, as Tom said, is really quite a dangerous substance which has psychotic effects, and we really can't, you know, I think we've been informed by this sort of rather mild view that we've perhaps grown up with, and I really do think that we've got to look much more closely at the health effects, at the psychological effects, at the effects on the workplace, because I think that's absolutely key as well. And at the end of the day, if we are bringing more powerful narcotics into our daily lives, then there are going to have to be more support services that we fund and pay for to deal with the fallout. And I think I go with Nigel that a Royal Commission to look very carefully at this before we take any further action would be very sensible.
Thank you. Gisela.
When I was in my time as a health minister, I was responsible for the government's drugs and alcohol strategy. And there's a whole range of different debates. I mean, Richard mentioned this question, is it a gateway drug? You know, do you start with cannabis or do you move on? To what extent do you have addictive personalities who, you know, and in a sense, all of us politicians, we are sort of slightly, we're work. Can you hear me now?
Hold it.
Can you hear me when I hold it? No. No. Do we need the microphone? Sorry? Better now? No. Okay. Is that better now?
No.
It means turning on. Yes. Once it's on, it's going to be fine. It's on.
It's on.
Right.
It's on. Yes. Analog. Analog woman struggling with technology yet again. When I was a health minister, I was in charge of the government's drugs and alcohol strategy. And there were a whole lot of debates about, is it a gateway drug, as Richard suggested, that people start with something? Is there such a thing as an addictive personality that people, you know, have become workaholics like most of us on the panel? Or do you take up some other drugs? And it's not straightforward. I think what, in the end, makes me think it's not right to either decriminalise, and I think, again, I tend to agree with the decriminalisation is a bit of a problem. But it's got... Can you hear me now? Yeah. I think it's got more to do with having had teenage children. And I think teenage, as you grow up, you've got to rattle the cage. You've got to do something your parents wouldn't approve of you doing. And then you realise why they said you shouldn't have 16 pints because it isn't a terribly nice thing to wake up. And then you grow up and get out of it. And I just think that if you take the bar out of as to what is legal and what isn't, I just think it takes into territory you really shouldn't. And the other observation is really important. I think the generation of the 60s sort of really does still think cannabis is just sort of slightly funny smelling cigarettes. It's much worse than that. So the answer is no.
Thank you very much.
Well, I wonder if my microphone is working. Good, thank you. I'm a bit ambivalent about the whole subject, I must say. When I worked at the Institute of Economic Affairs, they did a couple of studies on the economic aspects of this, and there was no doubt that there were huge gains if you just allowed the market to run in drugs. And the gains were mainly in respect of crime. A huge percentage, and I can't remember the precise amount, but it was something like 50% of crime comes through the drug-related activities. And to take that out of society is a huge gain if you can do it. On the other hand, my instinct was I'm very unsure about it, particularly as occasionally you read reports about the psychotic effects of cannabis users. And therefore, I'm rather attracted, although I've never heard it before, the Nigel Farage's idea that there should be a royal commission, and as if, Gisela will probably correct me if I'm wrong, but I understand a royal commission as opposed to a government commission is one where you take expert advice from all sides, technical, political, legal, and you really establish what is the way forward, because as other members have said, it's very unclear. And countries that have legalized certain forms of drugs like the Netherlands, it hasn't been 100% success. So to repeat, I'm ambivalent, but the economic gains could be considerable if we could cut down the aspect of a gateway to crime.
What is the impact on crime in the Netherlands where it's been legalised?
Well, I don't know precisely, but I do know that an interesting thing that Gisela probably knows this better than me, but the German police have drug patrols sort of 2 kilometres back from the Dutch border because they're worried about it. So, but the incidents, I don't know.
Can I just say that I've only learned just before we came onto this platform here that there's a difference between legalising drugs where, you know, as in Colorado, you can go into a shop and buy whatever you want, more or less, and decriminalising, such as in California, where it is effectively decriminalised, or they're very, very mild sanctions. I wonder whether I could ask the audience here, first of all, whether they believe that there is advantage in either legalizing or decriminalizing cannabis. Hands up. Oh my goodness. That's a very, 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 very small number. And those who don't, what about those who haven't made up their minds, who don't know? A very, very, very few of you. So we're still very much in the position where no one quite knows what the impact will be. So I think, why don't we, having given that a bit of an airing, move on to Matthew Crane, please.
Is it justified?
Oh, no, it's not on.
Is it justified for the government to spend taxpayer money on propaganda that is so one-sided?
Gisela, are you without a microphone? So I probably won't ask it. Keith, how about you?
I think the answer is very clearly no, it's not justified. It's not justified for two reasons. Number one, the Prime Minister said he wouldn't do it, and that certainly does not increase our trust in politicians in general. The second thing is it's following the precedent that was set by Harold Wilson, but of course Harold Wilson did this before the rules were set in place about funding of elections and referenda. So it's sort of getting to me between the wallpaper and the wall, because the Prime Minister seems to have been following the Wilson plan, go to the continent, come back, say that you've got a fantastic deal, and then spend our money on convincing us that it's a fantastic deal, which it doesn't look like to me. So I don't think it's justified in any way.
Richard.
I strongly disagree. I think it's, of course, the right thing to do. It is the majority position of the Cabinet, the majority position of the Conservative governing party that the British public just elected. It's overwhelmingly the majority position of members of Parliament, and that what this is the biggest question facing Britain for a generation. This is not about kicking the Prime Minister in the next 5 minutes. This is about the next 50 years of our country. And it is right and responsible of the government to set out not only its case, because it isn't the status quo per se on the ballot paper, but this negotiated change that has been mentioned, but also crucially that to press the importance of this debate going forward, because, like I said, it will make such a difference to our country. I believe that our country is better, stronger and more prosperous for being part of the EU. I don't believe we should be having the referendum at all, personally. This wasn't a referendum I wanted. But if we're having it, we must put forward the strong case. And I understand why people who want us to leave will want to make this about a question of trust in the Prime Minister, because they think that that's going to have an impact on the result. But this is about the future of our country, and it's about what we say about ourselves as a country. Are we open to our neighbours, to the world? Are we a welcoming and engaging country? Are we a country that wants to be modern? Are we a country that wants actually to be more powerful because we work with others to tackle climate change or tax avoidance or many of the other things that just cannot be done by a nation state any longer? And I think they were right to do it. I'm not a supporter of this government. I'm not a supporter of this Prime Minister. I think on this one, they got it right.
Gisela.
I think he was wrong, and he was wrong for three reasons. One was he quotes the Wilson precedent, but someone actually very kindly sent me a PDF of the Wilson pamphlets which went out, and Harold Wilson actually made up a far more balanced case. Whereas this wasn't a balanced case. The reason why it would have had to be a balanced case, by the way, is because as recently as 4 months ago, the Prime Minister confidently stated that, of course, we would be all right outside the EU. We're a confident country. So what I'm not quite sure is, unless some world crisis happened and I was asleep, as to what happened from, of course, we'd be perfectly right outside, and now if you vote exit, television sets will turn black and white, shower heads will no longer have water pressure, duvets will disappear, and Brentford Project Nylon fear. Sheets which crackle in the dark will appear again. And the third point is that we now have an electoral commission that is quite clear of a process. So as of midnight today, the two sites which are designated will get £700,000 from the taxpayer, and we are allowed to raise not from the taxpayer but raise up to £7 million to spend on the campaign. And yet, just before, the government spends £9.3 million. On one leaflet, which only tells one side. So it's utterly imbalanced. It's even in breach of its own rules. Lidington, the Europe minister, said as recently as September the government would not do it. So I think it is just wrong on every count.
I'm so old that I was actually the political secretary to Jim Callaghan during the 1975 referendum. And of course, the thing about this is that you'll get... let me say, if I was now the advisor to the Prime Minister or to the Foreign Secretary, I might have suggested they didn't do it, because I don't really think it's going to make that much difference to the way people vote. An old mentor of mine from the trade union days, Joe Gormley, once advised me, don't build platforms for malcontents to stand on. And quite frankly, that's what the leaflet is. It allows Gisela and her friends to cry foul. It's a very modest... I actually found it on my doorstep the other day. It is not going to... I suspect when the opinion polls ask you what was the decisive factor, this pamphlet will come a long, 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 long way down the list of decisive factors. But on the other hand, the government of the day, the Prime Minister of the day, has not only a right but a responsibility to advise the people on an issue of such importance. But I think he could have probably found less provocative ways of doing it.
Yes.
It's beginning to look as though you're on your own, Richard, but let's see, Steve.
Yeah. I can't get to agree with you, Richard.
You're the establishment now.
Can you hear me okay? I was fascinated, actually, by Tom's answer there. That this was, the implications wasn't a very impressive pamphlet. It wasn't going to make an enormous amount of difference in the debate. What I was fascinated about, I used to run a design and advertising agency, actually, in Hoboken. And they spent £458,000 creating it, not printing it, creating it. £458,000. I'd have done it for a lot less than that. But I'm still startled by this. Plus, one of the photographs has already been disowned by the chap that took it, who said, well, I'm a Eurosceptic, and I didn't give you permission to use it. Even amongst the 458,000. I actually Googled, what can you spend £9 million on in the public sector? And in 2013, when Henley wanted to build itself a new small hospital, it said, we need this to deliver for not more than £9 million. So it's the price of a small hospital that has been spent on this. And... pretty much all the sensible points have been made here. I think the key point is about trust. I think it's reasonable to say, that a Prime Minister can do this, and that he's done it, and fair enough. But it is about trust. David Livingstone, the Europe Minister, actually didn't say he wasn't going to do it. What he said was, the government isn't going to legislate to allow itself to take part in the campaign. classic political spin. So they didn't legislate, they just did it. And David Cameron said he wouldn't. Well, David Cameron has said, as has been pointed out, lots of things on this subject, like, for instance, of course we would survive perfectly well outside the European Union, as we all know. As the fifth largest economy in the world, that's a perfectly reasonable claim. Why we are now being treated to this extraordinary degree of fear and negative nonsense that is being pushed through our letterboxes, I don't know. Even Harold Wilson, I believe, Lord McNally will be able to correct me here, but I believe he actually put out arguments on both sides, although they were not necessarily entirely of the same weight. But he did put out a pamphlet saying, and this is what the other side say. So I'm looking forward to the government perhaps doing that. What do you think?
Yeah.
It doesn't surprise me, I have to say. Whether it's justified or not, it doesn't surprise me. It was a piece of trickery. It was about timing. It was about what you say and what you do. And coming from David Cameron doesn't surprise me at all.
Matthew, do you want to come back on that? Tell us what you think about the answers.
I think the main point that people have problems with was that it was taxpayer money. The Conservative Party does have its own funds if it wants to push its own personal opinion on the people. And I think, although they have a right to do so, it shouldn't have been at the expense of the taxpayer.
Can I just ask, how else would you think that the government would be able to keep the electorate informed about a point of view that the government, which has been duly democratically elected, holds? In what other way could they do that?
Cash in some offshore funds. Cash in.
What can you answer to that, you know?
I would say David Cameron can go on the BBC News and put his case towards British people for much less than £9 million. And also, I'm pretty sure that the government has a pretty large pot of money that it can spend on its own campaigning that could have been used if they wanted to put out pamphlets. I think it was unjustified for them to use taxpayer money when there are such deep cuts having to be made.
Thank you so much. Steve.
I just wanted to pick up on one point. Partly this has been caused by the fact that the Conservative Party declared itself neutral. And I think that's something that's worth bearing in mind. It said it was not going to take part in this. It was not going to take its spending allowance. It wasn't going to spend any money. And Conservatives could do as they pleased on either side. So I think that's the reason why, to a certain extent, he's been considered he's been forced into this. But I agree with you. He gets an opportunity to talk to us quite regularly, doesn't he, and make his feelings known without actually having to spend our own money sending us his opinions.
I think one of the things that we find is leading any political party on Europe is extremely difficult. I'm fascinated to find that Harold Wilson has suddenly become Honest Harold, yeah, in all this. I do remember when Harold brought his deal back from the Dublin summit, having gone through some very tortuous twists and turns. He stood at the dispatch box and he announced that the deal was a satisfactory and he was in favour of it. And for some reason, the speaker called Willie Gallagher, who was a Labour MP, but not a great fan of Harold Wilson's. And Willie stood up and said, "Prime Minister, some of us always knew you'd do it," and sat down to laughter on both sides. Keeping a party together on Europe, unless it's UKIP, is very difficult.
Yeah. I'm going to ask Richard to answer the point about taxpayers' money, but Gisela, you wanted to come?
You're right, Europe divides the parties, but shouldn't that tell the politician something? It's kind of, the reason why it does not divide the mainland of the continent, because they are searching for supranational identity, having seen the nation state fail. And we, in a sense, have a supranational identity, had it for the last 300 years, and it's called Britishness. And therefore, it goes to the core of understanding of what the nation states of these isles, how they see themselves. And if both political parties are finding it so difficult to cohere over the subject over a period of 40 years, shouldn't at some stage someone pause and say, there's some debate to be had which we as politicians aren't having?
Or shouldn't we have a debate on a referendum, as we did in 1975, get a 2-to-1 majority in favour of staying in and going ahead, and this is what we're doing again. And
no,
that is
not.
What we've already got in this is the excuses coming out for failure from the no side.
Yeah.
It really doesn't matter that much. And if your decision is going to be made about whether or not the government should or should not planted a leaflet, then you're addressing the wrong issue in the wrong way. And I also think, unless we find some other way of governing ourselves, we should stop making it sound like all politicians are twisters and only some outside force is making rational decisions. We're in a democracy and we're going through a democratic process. And I would strongly urge the No campaign to get on with making its arguments instead of crying foul at every turn.
Richard, taxpayers' money.
The point has been well made about how Wilson made the arguments. He made it in the best way that he thought to make the case at the time, and he thought by appearing fair and coming down on the balance of probabilities was the way to do that. He wasn't necessarily better motivated than anyone before him or after him. David Cameron thinks this is one of the ways in which he should make that case. And he didn't just find a key for Downing Street. You guys put him there. I was imploring you to put the other guy in. But, you know, 11 million people, 12 million people, I think, voted for David Cameron and his party to put them in, of which a majority of the cabinet and majority of his party's MPs who are elected by the public and a majority of the parliament think we should stay in. And we've got to press that this is the most important thing. What you see from the Leave campaign is they want this about everything else but the referendum, the process, the money, the this, the that, the trust, who happens to be in the Prime Minister's seat at a given time. This is about our direction of travel. This is not about the kind of day-to-day politics. This is about our future. And I think that sometimes these things are so important that the government thinks it is right to spend money on them. And this is one of those things that I think merits that.
We've got another two questions on your... Does someone want to ask... do you want to come in on that? Yes.
Yeah, my name's Steve Jones. I'm the last mayor of Beaconsfield. Your panel, particularly the pro-Europeans, talk very much about democracy in this country. Could they explain to me how the democracy of the EU works? Because I'm struggling to understand it. It seems to me a closed shop that favours those with the snouts in the trough, and the rest of us are left to pay the bill.
Well, I think you've answered your own question.
Yes.
With all the pejorative remarks. I went as a minister for 3.5 years, and every time I went, I felt a sense of pride and achievement that I was sitting round the table with 27 other countries talking and discussing about the future of our continent, when I think that 30 years, 50 years, 100 years ago, our continent were murdering each other in their hundreds of millions. If you don't think that what the EU has replaced is not something to be proud of, then perhaps that's why you're the last mayor of Beaconsfield.
I think we're going to have plenty of opportunity to talk more about the sort of European matters. Can I ask Anne Marshall to ask her question? Put it as
yes,
a question.
My question is also about the leaflet which has been delivered by the government. and it concerns something on page one, which states that we will keep our own border controls. Now, surely this is a complete nonsense, since Angela Merkel's made it very clear that we must have open-door immigration to all 27 other EU countries as long as we remain in the EU. I'd like to hear what the panel thinks.
Thank you. Everyone heard that, did they? Yes? Yes. Isla.
At the risk of being accused by Tom McNally of not answering the question, which with the last question I tried to, was it good spending of taxpayers' money rather than my reasons for saying we should get out? But there's three points. One is the word control, which is very interesting because it gives the impression that you both have control over your physical borders, but also the right to determine who can cross those borders. And it is very true that being outside the Schengen area, that free travel area, we have got the power to control our borders. What we have lost in some extent, or over a block of 350 million, is actually to determine who those people are who can come in and who can stay. And I think that you should be able to hold me to account to that decision. I'm a Birmingham MP, which masses of Indian subcontinent migration. And, you know, some of those families who are in the second, third generation find it really quite difficult as to why they've got a problem bringing in some of their family members for weddings. And yet, if you are from the Baltics or some of the East European, it's fully free travel. I think, as your MP, I should be able to be asked to give you an answer over that, so that whatever system we have, you hold me to account. And at the moment, you can't. That's one thing. Yes, it is. Richard, it is over three...
The reason why the immigration policies have changed is because there is a Conservative government that has changed the immigration policies. They put in an arbitrary cap, and that has put the pressure on from elsewhere, and they're making that decision. How many MPs are on the blue side means we have a different policy on immigration to when it was on the red side. One of the reasons why the public voted out the red side was because of that view, and they're entitled to take that opinion. And therefore the policy changed.
But over 350...
But to pitch Eastern Europeans...
Now, can you just... Are you going to allow me to make things? Yeah. And that takes me to the much more important point as to why I think the EU is an outdated institution. Because we've had three waves of globalization. Once was in terms of goods, and we created the World Trade Organization in the early 90s. So all those kind of imports come there. The second over capital, in 2008, we realized that, you know, we couldn't control the capital flows anymore. That part of that, all our institutions weren't sufficiently global enough. And the third, the current pressure on the EU's external borders. You know, Germany itself has just taken in 1.5 million. Shows that in globalization, we haven't got the answers to control that flow of the movement of people. And I really resent when I state a fact that you're telling me I'm pitching one group against another. I don't. But I think there should be judgments made for which you can vote me in and out. But over 350 million at the moment, you can't. And there's something wrong with that.
Steve.
Thank you very much. I just want to make one point right from the word-go. We should have immigration into this country. We always have. We always will. It is a good thing. But like almost every other country in the world, we should be able to consider it, manage it, make sure it is fair. And I particularly want to pick up on the point that was made there, that, and indeed Richard's point, which is you elect a government, and that government comes in on a manifesto that says, we're going to tighten up on immigration. So what can it do? Well, what it can do is it can take the constituents of Gisela's from the Indian subcontinent and make their lives more difficult. But it can't do anything about the other 50% of immigration that is happening, or whatever it might be, 50, 40, 60, we're not sure, at any given time, from the European Union, because it is simply, it's a hands-off. There's nothing they can do. There is free movement of people. And that is one of the most iniquitous things, really, that the European Union does. It means that if we want to control immigration at all, we have to be incredibly strict in controlling it from some places, because we are powerless in controlling it from other places. And that creates a real imbalance. There are 137 countries currently with trade deals with the European Union which do not include freedom of movement. So when David Cameron says, if we are going to have a trade deal with the European Union, we'll have to have freedom of movement, that is not true. And it isn't true because it's perfectly... Vietnam has a trade deal with the European Union. It doesn't have freedom of movement. And we just need to grow up and understand that we as a nation are a huge part of the global economy. We're the fifth largest, I said this, and this is one of my favourite things, we're the fifth largest economy in the world. We're also the eighth largest manufacturing nation in the world. Who knew that? We have every ability to stand on our own feet and to be a good neighbour to those countries in on the continent. And I don't underestimate what Tom McNally said earlier on about the motivations at coming out of the 20th century for those countries on the in continental Europe for wanting to find structures that would bind them close together so that they would not fight in the way that they have been doing before. I fully understand that process, but I'm afraid it is now an outdated concept. It has been badly designed at many points, and to be fair, whenever politicians get together and try and design things, they don't generally make a very good job of it, because, you know, something of that size and scale is kind of bigger than we can really manage. And the world has moved on. And we have, the European Union is a customs union. It is producing trade barriers to the rest of the world. It is making third world countries poorer. And really, we've got to grow up and move on and go to a better model where we can all thrive in a global economy.
Thank you, Chairman. I think...
quick question. Would it be all right to get our panellists to speak first and then I'll come back to you? Thank you very much. Thank you so much. I will come back to you, okay?
In the last 10 years, net immigration in this country has been approximately 3 million people. 3 million net of Brits who've left and others that have left. So we actually have taken quite a fair share of immigration into this continent. And I must say, when I saw Angela Merkel say you can all come, that's fine if she would like them to come to Germany, and then with the next breath she said you will all take your fair share, it sounded to me like hegemony belongs somewhere else. It also seemed to me rather bizarre to have a situation where immigrants are decided by people smugglers in Turkey. I think our immigration should be determined by us, by our needs, bearing in mind that England, I'm not including Scotland and Wales, but England is the most densely populated country in the whole of the EU. We have a lot of people here, and to start forcing people into this economy that we don't really want seems to me totally wrong. I believe that Cameron has finally said that we don't have to take criminals from the Baltic states who come here and murder people. That seems quite a good idea. But basically, it seems to me that we should be making that decision. And I remember attending a couple of years ago a speech by John Howard of Australia. And he was very polite because someone said to him, do you think the UK should be leaving the EU? He said, that's not for me. He said, but I'll tell you something. If you want to be a sovereign country, you have to control your own borders. And I think that that's exactly what he's saying.
Tom.
Yeah. Where does one begin on once Baltic murderers are thrown into the argument? Immigration is, I do agree with Gisela that we are now in a kind of third wave of immigration, of globalization, the movement of people. That's why you see it as a problem in the United States, elsewhere. I mean, we are a wealthy beacon. I watched last night a group of people not coming from Syria or Afghanistan or any of those places, but from sub-Saharan Africa. And what English they had, they came because it was a better life, which has moved immigrants for centuries. And we have had, my name's McNally, 150 years ago, the McNallys came from west of Ireland. How we manage that is going to be a very complex and difficult issue. And it certainly will not be solved by a fortress England. And, you know, when Gisela says that we have solved the problem of multinational cooperation in this United Kingdom, I tell you that if you go for Brexit, there is a real danger that you lose Scotland, and there is a very real danger that both Northern Ireland and Wales will think twice. So this idea that somehow we are going to remain as this safe, snug little island with our walls against immigration, it certainly hasn't happened in my lifetime, but I agree that it's time politicians face some of the real problems of what's going on in this globalization of people moving across continents in a way that is, we have not seen since the end of the Second World War. But our chance of solving it, in my mind, are far better within a European Union than trying to do it in the way that Gisela and her friends are suggesting.
Nearly all of our friends, not all. Can we please go to our audience? Yes.
Good evening, my name is Tom Bonsall. Given that on one hand we have a history of being the destination of choice for wave after wave of hard-working migrants from former Soviet bloc countries, and then on the other you have the rise of newly industrializing countries in, say, for example, Southeast Asia with Taiwan, India and China, how would the panel advise our government on preserving our country's historic place on the global market?
How long have you got? Richard, I'm going to ask Richard just to give a quick response to that, and then I'm going to move on to the next question, because I think that is going to engender a discussion which will answer your question. Richard, yeah.
Well, it comes back partly from Stephen's point where he said we have trade deals with Vietnam, I think was the example that you used, and we don't have freedom of movement with those countries. What we don't have is a free trade agreement with those people. And where you have a free trade agreement, like Norway has, like Switzerland, that does go with the free movement of people. And other than some on the fringes of UKIP, most are saying that if they left, they would want to stay part of that free trade agreement and area, and therefore that would go with it. So I'm afraid there isn't an option in this election where immigration's off the ballot paper. There isn't an option where Russia's not aggressive to Ukraine, where the Middle East isn't in difficulty, and where North Africa isn't poor. And I do slightly object to being lectured by UKIP, who stood on a platform of cutting aid, that they want to come out of the EU because somehow it's bad for poor countries and it's making Africa poorer. This is ridiculous, and I don't think it's true. The issue about trade is an important one, and I think we're stronger by being in the EU, but it's why I call the kind of 5% problem, is we are that bit better by being in Europe. I'm not saying we're going to go to hell in a handcart if we leave. Britain is a great country and we're fine on our own, but I think we are better. We haven't negotiated or agreed or signed a trade deal for some time now in this country. We don't really have those expertise. It's not something we've done for a while. And I fear it's going to be a bit like the early PFI deals, where some of them were good and some of them weren't so good, and they had real problems in them. But what we want and what we're part of is this trading block of 500 million consumers, where we can sit down with the emerging markets that you talked about and get a good deal for our country with our neighbours. But crucially, when you go to India or Brazil or something to sell something British, you're often not up against a Brazilian, French, Indian or Chinese company. You're up against a French or German one. So you need a big home market to be productive and efficient to sell the best products to the rest of the world. And we get the best of the both worlds by being in the EU and having a good home market, and therefore have the best products for the world market.
Yeah.
Keith, one point, and then I'm going to go to the next question.
I just want to respond to the point, because we heard Switzerland mentioned. My daughter and son-in-law live and work in Switzerland. It is true that there is free movement, but you have to have a work permit to work in Switzerland. They have more control than we have. So this idea that we hear here when we get the party political broadcast on the left, that these countries have the same free movement as within the European Union, it is not true, and I know that personally.
If we had no permit, would you be in favour of staying in the EU? That's not a non sequitur.
We should control immigration, whichever way is the best way to do it.
We've got the third EU question, which I'm going to ask Harry Wells to ask.
My question is, how far will leaving the European Union affect the amount of foreign investment
business? Keith.
Well, the interesting thing about this question is that at the time of the debate, should we join the euro or not join the euro, everyone said that foreign direct investment into this country would fall. It's powered ahead. And what is also interesting is, and I've worked for many years in the City of London, is that the city, when faced with difficulties because there was not a free market in services into the European Union, actually went out to the wider world. And it became more successful. It became the biggest foreign dealing place in the world. It overtook New York. So I don't believe it'll stop, for the simple reason people don't come here because we're part of the European Union. They come here because of English law. So you see Russian businesses taking action against other Russian businesses in the UK courts. They come here because of the English language. They come here because our language is, because our regulation is better. They come here because our services of the financial nature are much better. And therefore, we would be successful. We may even be much more successful. And there's at least one study that has said that.
Thank you so much. Steve.
This is one of the big kind of Project Fear planks, which has been going on now for quite a long time, up until quite recently when we started to get into this referendum run-in. I remember that the poor old chap who runs Nissan used to be wheeled out once a year to say, oh, no, we mustn't even think of leaving the EU because we make cars here and we wouldn't do that anymore if we came out. And what's quite interesting is that as we've got closer and closer and closer and we are having the referendum and then the question is being asked, these big companies are one by one being put under the spotlight. And they'll be wheeled out again by the campaign, say, oh, no, it's much better if we stay in the EU. But when they're actually then cross-examined by journalists, and they say, well, if we don't stay in the EU, are you going to completely change your investment strategy? They go, no. And they've done it one after another. Nissan have done it. Hitachi have done it. GE, GM. Boeing is currently making a big investment into this country, despite the fact that we are 50-50 at the moment in the polls, that we might actually leave the European Union. And there is a strong reason for this. And that is that businesses are not political and moral things, they are businesses. So if you say to them, would you like this thing that actually looks after you quite nicely to stay? They go, yes. And if you then say to them, will you be able to survive if you don't? They go, yes, because that's what businesses do. Now, the European Union is to a great extent, and it's one of the reasons why there is such a coalition across the spectrum in the Leave campaign, the European Union is essentially designed for large vested interests. In particular, it is designed for big companies. It is designed to make their lives easier if they can afford big compliance departments, if they can put their lobbyists into the committees in Brussels that come up with the draft laws, then everything works nicely. They can really settle things amongst themselves. The barriers to entry for smaller businesses get worse and worse and worse, and that favours big businesses. So actually, no. We are an immense economy. We are a very strong, and has been said, international economy, and it will be exactly the same as has been said before, as what happened when we were told we would never survive not being in the euro. We will power forward. The investment will. I'm not going to tell you, by the way, what the investment levels will be, whether they'll rise or fall, because there is a great. No, I don't know. Because that's the point. We keep being asked on the Leave side, why don't you paint a picture of what life is going to be like in the future? Well, ask the Chancellor if he's going to paint a picture of exactly what the economy is going to look like in 6 months' time. Politicians doing that are lying to you. What I am saying is there is no strong reason to suppose that we can't thrive outside the European Union and attract more direct investment.
There's always this problem with questions which look in the future, and usually it can create the worst fears and your greatest hopes. But let's just analyse this, because it's quite right. It's one of those questions where we have a precedent, and that was the argument over what will happen if we don't join the euro. And it's virtually just insert phrase, change date. All the stuff which we were told about will happen if we don't join the euro. We're now being told about investment, and when we didn't join the euro, none of these things happened. But there are two things which we do know about, and I urge you to spend a bit of time about that. We do know that those countries who have the euro require deeper political integration. And there's a plan called the Five Presidents Plan, which was published last year in the summer, and I really urge you to read it, because it maps out clearly what the European Union has to do in the next 5, 10, 15 years to achieve that deeper political integration. And if you want to read Mervyn King, the former governor of the Bank of England's book, Alchemy, there's a chapter there on the euro where he says the euro either requires a country called Europe or it will fail. And neither scenario is one which I think is right for us. The second thing is on investment. Recently, a few years ago, I talked to a car manufacturer, and they're creating battery-driven cars. Actually, and I said to them, so where are you going to produce it? And they said, well, the more sophisticated the technology, the closer is your manufacturing base to where you did the research. So as long as, whether it's the battery car or whether it's the hydrogen car up in Birmingham, if you do the research, the high-skilled research in this country, and you've got the skilled workforce, you will have the investment. And if you don't have the research and you haven't got the skills, we will never be able to undercut them on wages. So foreign investment, and the question is specifically about foreign investment will come here if we've got innovative products, if we've got the research and the workforce. And if we don't have those three things, they will not come here, whether we're part of the EU or not.
Yeah.
Well, certainly I do not believe in project fear. As somebody said, I actually did an economics degree, but my favourite quote is that economists are men trained to predict the past. So what would exactly happen, we don't know. But you're the jury, and it is worthwhile taking evidence from those who are going to have to live with the consequences. There's an article in tonight's Evening Standard, which I read in the way here, where the city editor said he could not find a leader of a City 100, FTSE 100 company who was willing to speak up for Brexit. The Institute of Directors are opposed to Brexit. The TUC is opposed to Brexit. The CBI is opposed to Brexit. Now, these all aren't collections of devious politicians. They are, when you scratch the surface, men and women who are going to have to take the consequences of the decision that you're going to make in June. And I do think it's fair to say, I mean, Gisela's quite right. In or out, we've got to face the fact that our productivity is something like 17% lower than Germany. That's one of the reasons why we need to work harder at the economics of this country. We need to do better than successive governments are doing about retaining our industrial base in a way that Germany has done very successfully within the EU. We perhaps need to get more than 6% of our girls, I shouldn't say this at a boys' school, but 6% of our girls train in engineering. Those are the statistics that hold us back. But I do think that it, as the jury in making this decision, it is worthwhile listening to those who are at the sharp end of economic and industrial decisions, just as I think it's worthwhile listening to why the fact that our security services, our Home Secretary, who was not a well-known Euro fanatic as far as I know, but those that have had to come to terms with the reality of keeping this country safe, have all advised against Brexit. I mean, you can blame the politicians all you want, and don't listen to the Prime Minister or his pamphlet, but listen to the people who are working at the sharp end of industry, of commerce, of the City of London, and in other areas, in defence and in security, and you will find that the evidence is overwhelmingly to warn you that this is a leap in the dark to take us out.
But Tom, the CBI, the IOD, FTSE 100 said exactly the same thing about the euro.
Gisela, I'm going to ask Richard. Richard, what evidence can you bring to bear on foreign investment questions?
Well, if you take what Gisela was just saying, the best way to have the best jobs is to be situated near the research. So what do the researchers say? The scientists say we should stay in because it's the best condition for having the best research. Universities UK and just about every good university around this country, including, I imagine, the University of Birmingham, wants us to stay in. That's where the research is done. That's why we have the best researchers here in Britain. And they think the best conditions for doing that is by being in the EU. Don't look at me like that. That's what they say. Like, they are the people making that case. Because, as Tom said, they're the people who have to make some of the hard choices going forward. And you know, we might have found that Boeing as the example that is investing now while we're in the middle of this debate, but people are saying they are holding back some of their decisions just to wait and see. But what they're not doing, and what I slightly resent, is we have words put in our mouths, those of us who want to keep the status quo and stay in the EU, that we are saying that there'll never be anybody ever invested in Britain ever again if we were to leave. That, of course, is not the point that's being made. But we think these are the best conditions. And I want Britain to be in the best situation, not with one hand tied behind our back. And the kind of offer that is put to us is like leaving the AA without the RAC to go to. You wouldn't do it with your car, so don't do it with your country. Like, it is a really good system that does work for us at the moment. It has loads of problems with it. I always resent paying my AA membership. But sometimes it's a good scheme to be part of, and we shouldn't do the same kind of silliness with our country, because the people who want us to leave can't pitch what it's going to be like being out, because it is uncertain, it is unclear. But on their own definition, as Giza said, that the way we have the best jobs in this country is by being situated near the research. Ask the researchers what they say they want to be in.
Yeah. Let's have some views from the audience. We've got one here, one at the back there, and one on this side here. So first of all, here.
Thank you. I think many of us here consider it would be a leap into the light. That's the first point. And secondly, the CBI and many other quangos, charities and lobby groups are funded by the EU. And you're not mentioning that. You're not mentioning that. And recently, the leaders of France and Germany said Europe wasn't working, and their answer, give us more, let's enlarge, let's have 76.5 million Turks, of whom their own president says at least 8% are ISIS supporters, let them all come here. This is the reason you kids won't get a house, because supply and demand, because there is not enough housing for people here, there is not enough schools or doctors or anything. Get wise, we've got to control our borders and stop the EU funding propaganda.
Sorry, someone back there. Thank you.
My well,
My question, my proposition is, surely this talk of what's best for the economy, what's best for business, is just because it is purely that. It's best for business, it's best for the CEOs, it's best for those businesses, not necessarily, which tends to be the argument normally, the best thing for us. Surely it is more important for us that we leave the EU to get power over our own decisions rather than being told by a business elite to vote for what is preferential for them.
Someone on this side here at the back, yes. Was it you? Yes, yes.
Surely there's also the project fear on the other side. We do not know that by remaining in the European Union, quite where we are going. There is no manifesto, and we are totally and utterly led by unelected people who do not tell us what the future is in the European superstate. They have even come up with projects that they want to illustrate or show us further, which will come out after the referendum, and they are keeping quiet on that subject until then.
Thank you. One more question, and then I'm going to ask the panel to come back very briefly on these comments. One more question here. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm a don't know. I'm a genuine don't know. But one of the things that is in my mind is I'm not sure I've got any more faith in Westminster than I do in Brussels, actually. My question is to do with if the UK votes to leave, does Cameron and Osborne resign?
I don't think we know that, actually. We can make regresses. Tom, come back on that sort of briefly, would you?
Let me try and gather my thoughts on that. On that, it certainly would be a new day, and I think the political momentum would change a great deal within the Conservative Party. But on the broader side, well, I think it was the interventions, if I may say so, were very helpful in terms of where Project Fear lies in this debate. And I think the economic arguments will always be fiercely decided. The lady who was talking about democracy and everything, I mean, I think one of the problems that we've had in convincing the British people about Europe is that ever since that we've engaged in this, and you know, successive prime ministers have come to the conclusion that our future lay with Europe, once we were in, it became very convenient for successive governments to blame Brussels for everything that went wrong, and take the credit for themselves that everything that went right. And boy, have we been bitten on the bum by that tactic, because that's exactly what the SNP are now doing with us as far as Scotland's concerned. But the truth is that European decisions are made by elected politicians going to Brussels, as I did myself, and sat around a table to debate and discuss. And one of the things I always remembered was I asked at one meeting, who was the guy sat at the end? Oh, that's the Norwegian. He's not allowed to speak, he's not allowed to vote, but they have to accept all the regulations that we make. Let me go one beyond this as well, and then I will shut up about Europe. But I belong to the generation that didn't fight in the war. I'm not that old. But I did have a lot of the... I have worked in Westminster since the mid-60s. And I did meet that generation that came back with a mission as far as Europe's concerned, and it was a mission of never again. And I had at one time the honour of working with Jean Monnet, who was once called the father of Europe. And I asked him, what was it that motivated him in far driving forward? And he said, I wanted to create something that would make it impossible for France or Germany ever to go to war again. And in that creation in Western Europe. You know, when people talk about the Middle East will never be solved, Kashmir will never be solved, I think we in Europe have demonstrated to the world that we can bury old enmities and work together around a table, arguing it out, sometimes boring, sometimes not always winning, but showing people the way of governing ourselves and making a contribution to the world, which I do think is an example. And quite frankly, is far more important as far as a contribution and a far better thing to offer to the young people. One of the things that worries me is that the old people are going to say, vote out, and it's the young people who are going to have to live with the consequences.
Very good. Very briefly, Gisela.
No, but you are right, except that. That meant the original six, Germany and France, will not go to war again. But I'm worried about the trajectory of the next 15, 25 years. For Schengen to work, you're going to need a deeper integration. You're going to need a European border force. You're going to need the nascent European army. For the euro to work, you're going to need a Europe finance ministry. Read the five presidents' reports. And that's the bit which in Maastricht we opted out of. So we know the European Union will go somewhere. And when they talk about peace, Sean Mooney was absolutely right. However, I resent it when we say the economic stability was at the back of NATO, which provided the defense stability. And the crisis in the euro and the youth unemployment that the euro has created is no longer providing the economic stability which was providing the European settlement. You're only providing half a picture. And the trajectory which we've got in now is high instability, and the structure which we're heading for is democratically unaccountable. And the most amazing thing was that young man over there who absolutely said, this is not about vested interests. Of course, all the vested interests are for that. What's the best for democracy? And democracy means you can get rid of your government. I cannot get rid of those who make decisions on my behalf in Brussels.
That's not true.
It is.
Please, very briefly.
Yes, I'll just say two things. The first thing is General de Gaulle, who was actually a man who preserved the honour of France in the Second World War, and whatever we think about his attitude to us, one must admire that. He said, the European Union is about France and Germany, and this is a direct quote, I wish I could say it in French, the rest are just the trimmings. And he was right. Because stopping France and Germany having a fourth war was really very important for the rest of us. Secondly, the contribution to NATO, which preserved the peace in Western Europe, in GDP terms, was greater by this country by multiples of 2 and 3 times than most countries and the rest of the continent. To say that we weren't contributing to that by some of the present people is ridiculous. The third thing, when I hear these stories about this huge benefit in security, I worked in a charity dealing with refugees from Bosnia, in Bosnia, not coming here. And interesting statistics. Most people don't know that Bosnia was a very small country, 3.9 million people only. The European Union stopped the Americans getting involved. They said, this is the hour of Europe. And you know what happened? 100,000 people dead later, 250,000 casualties. NATO had to go in and sort it out. So I don't believe in this idea that Brussels, who can't make decisions quickly, will ever provide the right security. And I know that from personal experience.
Not more than 2 sentences.
So multinational NATO can sort it out and make decisions, but multinational Europe can't. We had one question which was about unelected elites in Europe, and the other one about resigning our elected politicians. We don't like the people who govern us. That, we're allowed to have that view. We turn up every 5 years and vote for them, but we don't like anybody who makes decisions on our behalf. But somebody will be. We'll have a government in Westminster, Europe, wherever if we carry on. But I wanted to make this point really quickly. I am not a politician, I am a commentator, but I am firstly an employer. And I have to work out if I've got enough money in the bank account to pay our staff every month going forward. And if I find an arrangement that could help me do that and make that bit easier, or mean I could take on another young person and give them an opportunity, I will want to take that. So these businesses aren't saying it's over and we'll never employ anyone again. They're saying we can do it under these rules. We know how these rules work. We have even ideas about how to make them better. But they'll make it that bit easier, and I'll lose one less sleepless night knowing that I can pay my staff. And most of these employers do actually feel a responsibility to their staff.
That's more than two sentences. I have Steve.
Thank you. I'll try and keep it short. It is about balance of risk, as has been pointed out. And I'm grateful to Richard because he said it makes it easier. Yes, I have been a Eurosceptic since 1978. And one of the reasons is people were saying then it would be very hard if we left. And I've always thought, well, why is that something you don't do? Why do we just always avoid the difficult thing and do the easy thing? What are we giving up to get that? And what we're now hearing as we get close to the referendum is we're getting messages coming out of the EU now saying, actually, if you come out, there could be a domino effect and others will come out as well. Well, how good is that organisation if that's the case? I once had the chance to talk to somebody who had signed the Maastricht Treaty. And I said, what do you think is the future of the EU? And he said, it'll one day collapse under the weight of its own contradictions. And I thought, well, I don't want to be standing under it when it does.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to do a really, really, really quick thing and see whether anyone's prepared, first of all, to say that they support Brexit. And those who support Remain. And those who don't know yet. I think the Remainers have it so far. Yeah, and very interesting. Okay, right. Thank you so much. Let's go on to the next question, which is from Daniel Lawrence.
It's nothing to do with Europe, but it does come back to...
Yes, we finished Europe now.
More general point that was made
done
a few
Europe.
Minutes ago.
Yeah.
Would the panel agree that if we want to get more of our young people involved in politics, what we really need is a more representative voting system?
That's a question which is made for Tom.
Well, except we did ask you that a little while ago under the coalition government.
A very slightly more representative voting system.
Well, are you suggesting that if we'd have gone for full PR, we'd have swept the board?
Had there also not been a campaign that somehow suggested that voting yes would lead to firefighters not getting their uniforms and babies not having maternity
leave? I think we are moving we have moved over the last 40, 50 years into a multi-party system. One always quotes the 1951 election when 96% of the electorate voted either Labour or Conservative. And of course, those of you who are Savoyards will know that Gilbert and Sullivan said every boy and every girl born in this world alive is either a little liberal or a little conservative. And our voting system works for a two-party system. It doesn't work for a multi-party system, which turns general elections into a kind of Russian roulette where you're never quite sure what you're going to get. So I do think eventually we will have to move to a voting system that recognises that we are no longer a two-party system and try and get something that recognises that.
Thank you so much. Richard?
I support there being voting reform. I would go for a first-past-the-post plus, which makes me a very nerdy person for doing that, and an additional member system, a very minor change. But I don't believe it would deliver the diversity that I think you're actually asking for in your question. Our politics doesn't look enough like the people it seeks to represent, doesn't feel it speaks for them in the right ways at the right time, and that is a real crisis that we're having at the moment. And I think we are caught at the moment between wanting our politicians to be utterly fallible and absolutely perfect all at the same time. We want people who've had very normal backgrounds, and then we want to keep putting them through more and more tests. And what those tests do is putting people like me involved, who train those people and teach them how to sometimes not answer the question or avoid going down one route or the other, or having to save up money for the time where they can plan and plot their route into Parliament. Whereas actually I want my mum, the dinner lady, to have had that opportunity to go and do it, not somebody who had to be premeditated about doing it. And I think it's not the electoral system that means we have an unrepresented politics, but the expensive nature of it. I think sometimes the nature of a 24-hour media and wanting everyone to know everything all the time in that second contributes. I wouldn't get rid of it. I can't blame the media. But I think there's just a climate that is meaning some people feel politics is not for them, and we must change that.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you so much. Thank you, Richard.
Can I just confirm that the question is get more young people?
Yeah, yes, yes.
Oh,
yes.
Well, more people, but the teacher here encouraging my form to register to vote, which they need to do by Monday, I can well understand that in lots of areas of the country, and this is one of them, it is easy to feel like your vote is wasted.
Right, okay, just clarify that, because I think that I would answer it two different ways, actually. If it is about young people, I would say probably no, because actually proportional representation will get more people like me into politics, which would be lovely. I think young people are where ideology and passion, political passion, are bred. And actually, young people have effectively adversarial political ideas, and they work them out, and they clash, and rightly so. So actually, I think in some ways, that sort of the system that we have, which is about essentially opposites that clash, does help people to develop their political passion. And it's only when you get to my age that you actually would quite like a proportional representation system. It means that you can actually go and do your bit. It's a really difficult one, this, because I've seen, from my party clearly would benefit politically, electorally, from proportional representation. Does that mean that it's the right thing to do? Well, it may be in a pragmatic sense, but is it actually the right thing to do? I compare the Westminster system with the European Parliament system, where the Westminster system we've all grown up with, and we all go, oh, it's Yarboo politics, and every new Prime Minister says, I'm going to do away with Yarboo politics, and does he? No. There's more of it than ever. But it's about this whole kind of clash between Her Majesty's government and Her Majesty's loyal opposition. Her Majesty's loyal opposition, which is an official thing, and they are there to clash with the government and to say, you really convince me, that you're doing the right thing. I'm going to hate everything you do, and you have to convince me that it's the right thing to do.
Steve,
and then
I
you
stop
go
you there so that we can have
I'm so sorry.
Have Keith and then Gisela. Very briefly.
Yes, perhaps I have some experience of other systems, because one of the side benefits, I suppose, of being the representative of Slovenia at the time of their struggle for independence, is I was awarded by the Slovene government Slovene citizenship. So I paid attention, and I can vote in Slovenia, so I paid attention to their proportional system. And I will tell you, do not go down that route. You end up with five or six parties, you end up with three or four people at the top of each party who are permanent politicians. They never disappear. You never get proper decisions made. And having looked and being asked by the Slovenes what I think about it, I looked at other systems in Europe, and I must say the only one that I thought was reasonable was the German hybrid system, which seemed to combine it. And I thought that maybe we, if we did anything, we'd keep our first past the post, where the power lies in the Commons, and we have a proportional system, a genuine proportional system, in the House of Lords.
Oh, right, OK. Gisela.
And the wonderful German system was introduced by the British occupying forces in Africa. Because that's how the Brits would have done it if they started from scratch again, which would have richer. But I may not look it anymore, or if ever. However, I was a Blair babe. And there was that wonderful
photograph of 101 Labour women outside Church House.
I remember that.
And this was the largest intake of women in any one government. And it meant with 121 women in 1997, we had in one intake more women in Parliament than the entire history of Parliament. And the reason why I'm to this day so unbelievably proud of that picture is because it had there Claire Ward, who came in from Watford, who was 28 years old, and it had Anne Cryer, who was the widow of Bob Cryer, who came in with her son, who was also elected in another one. And what it meant is any woman who had ambition to go into politics could look at that picture and she could find one or two who were like her and could say, she made it and so can I. And I think the real problem we've got at the moment is by far too much politics becomes a profession rather than having had a job before and coming in. And the final point, do you know the most depressing moment I've had in politics was this week over the whole Panama paper release. I thought there was the most extraordinary story, you know, 11 billion gigabytes or whatever, and it's so big I don't know how big it is. A journalist had this stuff for 9 months, an international consortium, money laundering of an industrial scale involving North Korea, Egypt, every baddie under the sun. And what do we discuss in Parliament? The Prime Minister's tax returns.
Gisela, you know, I'm going to leave you with your disgust, OK? Now, we're coming right to the end. We've got really just a very few minutes. I'm going to ask James Hoggett to ask his question, but before doing so, I'm going to tell the panel here, I only want a yes or a no. That's all I want from you. James Hoggett.
Is Jeremy Corbyn electable?
Tom.
Attlee, Heath, Thatcher, yes.
Gisela.
He's already been elected as leader of the Labour Party, yes.
Yes. Heath. Yes.
I fear not.
He doesn't say to what, darling?
Steve.
Is he electable?
I guess.
How are you? I have to thank the panel. I'm going to thank them formally now before I thank all of you. Steve Crowther, Richard Angell, Keith Miles, Gisela Stuart, Tom McNally, thank you so warmly for your honesty and your courage in facing this very daunting audience. And can I thank all of you very much for your honesty and for participating in this panel. Thank you.
Thank you, my darling. Well done. I've done this kind of thing before.